Welcome to my video on the Kirby-Bauer test. In this video, I'll go over the steps on how to perform a Kirby-Bauer and how to interpret the results. But before I do that, let's go over the theory of the test. The Kirby-Bauer test is used to determine if a bacterial isolate is either sensitive or resistant to a set of specific antibacterial drugs. Now, this is key in a clinical microbiology setting because the isolates in which the microbiologist is working with comes from a patient that has a bacterial infection. So the idea is that if we can identify a drug in which the bacteria is sensitive to, then that drug can be used to treat the infection. Sometimes what the clinical microbiologist will find is that the drug does not have an effect on the bacteria. We're going to say that the bacteria is resistant to the antibiotic drug. So let's now take a look at the reagents that are required to perform a Kirby-Bauer test. First, we need a plate that contains the patient's bacterial isolate. Now, this plate was streaked for isolation, so that means it has an area of heavy bacterial growth in which we eventually diluted the amount of bacteria on the plate and we have individual colonies, so isolated colonies. These colonies should look identical, since we want to start with a pure culture. Next, we're going to need some sterile cotton tip swabs. We will need a container of sterile phosphate buffered saline, or PBS. We can substitute this with normal saline if we need to. We'll also need a 0.5 McFarland standard tube. Now, this tube is special because it has beryllium sulfate, and it'll have a certain cloudiness to it that mimics that of a tube that contains bacterial cells. So the cloudiness is identical to a tube that will have 1.5 times 10 to the 8th bacterial cells per mil. And that's what we're going to reach. We're going to try to suspend that amount of bacteria inside this tube here. More on that in a second. The last reagents that we'll need is a Müller-Hinton auger plate. Now, this plate is going to be considerably larger than a standard Petri dish, and we're going to need a series of paper discs that contain different antibacterial agents. So let's start out by taking one of our sterile cotton tip swabs. We're going to try to pick up a few isolated colonies, one or two, it depends on the size of these colonies, and we want to suspend them inside our sterile tube of phosphate buffered saline. Now, we want to be careful that we don't suspend too much bacteria into this tube. So we want to compare the cloudiness or the turbidity of the bacterial suspension in the sterile PBS tube with that of the 0.5 McFarland tube. So remember, the 0.5 McFarland standard tube will have a turbidity that matches that of 1.5 times 10 to the 8th cells per mil. So we want to compare the two tubes. We want to compare the bacterial suspension in the sterile PBS with the cloudiness or turbidity in the 0.5 McFarland tube. We want to match them. So if we can achieve that, we know that we're going to have roughly 1.5 times 10 to the 8th bacterial cells per mil in this tube. Now, that's important because if we add too much bacteria in this tube, then we might overwhelm the system. If we have too little, then we might not have a nice zone of inhibition. So we want to have approximately 1.5 times 10 to the 8th bacterial cells per mil in this tube. Okay, that swab will go away. And we'll take our second swab. We'll dip it inside the bacterial suspension. We'll wring out the edges so that the swab is not too wet. And we'll streak it across the center of this plate. So we're basically transferring bacteria from the sterile PBS tube onto the surface of this Müller-Hinton auger plate. With the same swab and without going back into the sterile PBS tube, we're going to basically go across that first streak and spread the bacteria over the entire surface of the plate as much as we can. Now, often what helps is that if we rotate the plate and swab the surface again in the opposite directions, and you can do this again. The idea is to spread the bacteria evenly on the entire surface of the Müller-Hinton auger plate. Next, we're going to use a dispenser that basically adds the paper disc containing the antibacterial agents onto the surface of the auger plate. Now, we're looking directly over the auger plate, but if I take the plate and move it on its side, here's a side view, We're going to take that auger, that paper disc, and we're going to layer it on top of the surface of the auger that's been freshly streaked with bacteria. Now, while we incubate this plate, the antibiotics that are inside this paper disc are going to diffuse inside the auger. And while it's doing that, the bacteria that's been spread on the surface is going to begin to grow. So there's a competition between the growth of bacteria and the diffusion of antibacterial agents outside the discs. And what you're going to see, if the antibacterial reagent has any effect on the bacteria, you're going to see a zone of inhibition. So I'm showing you that here and here. Now the zone of inhibition is going to be a circular clearing zone around the paper disc in which there's no bacteria that's visibly growing. The darker yellow here is the bacterial growth. Okay. So we want to see if we have a specific zone of inhibition. Again, if we didn't use a 0.5 McFarland, then we could add too much bacteria and the zone of inhibition would be smaller than it should be. Okay, so we're going to measure these zones of inhibitions, and to do that, we need to use a ruler. Typically, the ruler will have inches on one side and centimeters on the other side. We want to use the side that has centimeters. And so you need to know the difference between centimeters and millimeters, because we want to record our results in millimeters. Now, on this ruler, we have increments from 0, 1, 2, 3, all the way to 15. These increments are in centimeters. Now you have to remember that 1 centimeter is equal to 10 millimeters. So if you look at anywhere between any of these numbers, for instance, between 6 and 7, there are 10 smaller divisions. Each of these divisions represents 1 millimeter. So for instance, between 0 and 5, that's 5 centimeters, but 5 centimeters is equal to 50 millimeters. So whatever number you have in centimeters, just multiply by 10 and you will have millimeters. We're going to use this ruler and we're going to measure the diameter of each of these zones of inhibitions. Now, a diameter of a circle, notice that all these zone of inhibitions are circular form. So the diameter of a circle is a straight line that begins at the edge of the perimeter of the circle. It passes through the center of the circle and ends at the opposite edge. So as shown here. So this red line represents the diameter of this zone of inhibition. Showing you again in picture form here, here's a disc, here's the bacterial growth, and here's my zone of inhibition. So in this figure, the diameter of this zone of inhibition is 35 millimeters. So you can do this by centimeters, 1, 2, 3.5 centimeters. If you multiply that by 10, you'll have 35 millimeters. Now, sometimes these zone of inhibitions run into each other, so it's going to be very hard, and what you might have to do is record the radius instead. Now, the radius of a circle is a straight line that begins at the center of the circle and ends at one of the edges. So I'm going to show you that right here. So here's a disc, the center of the disc, and if I measure the distance from that center to the edge, this is the radius. So it's kind of intuitive if we go the opposite direction, we have the same answer, the radius. So the radius times 2 is going to equal that of the diameter. Now in this picture, the radius starts at the center, goes to the edge, and I have that the radius is 17.5 millimeters. Now, 17.5 millimeters times 2 is equal to the diameter, which is 35 millimeters. Okay, so you should get the same answer, you know, whether you do radius times 2 or just the diameter. But be careful if you rely on the radius, because some people will get into trouble and they will not start at the center of the disc. Instead, they will start at the edge. If you start at the edge of the disc, you're not measuring the true radius because you're missing a piece of that radius, and therefore you're missing twice the amount for the diameter and you'll get the wrong answer. So make sure for the Kirby-Bauer that you know that you're going to measure the diameter in millimeters, know how to use the ruler and know what millimeters are. And if you have to go to radius, make sure you start at the center and multiply that by 2 to get the diameter. Another thing that you need to know is that some discs, the bacteria will grow all the way up to the edge of that disc. That means that this antibacterial reagent had no effect at all on the growth of the bacteria. Some students are going to report this as 0 millimeters, but the disc itself has a diameter. So never record your results as 0 millimeters. Record your results as the diameter of the disc. In this case, the diameter of the disc is 6 millimeters. If we look at K30, which is kanamycin, K30 gave us a result of 3 centimeters. Here's centimeters, but 3 times 10. The diameter is 30 millimeters. P30 gives us a diameter of 24 millimeters. And N30 gives us a diameter of 10 millimeters. You're going to record these numbers on a chart as shown here. Okay. So on that Kirby-Bauer plate, we had different discs of chloramphenicol, erythromycin, etc., all the way down to neomycin. And these codes represent the antibiotic and the concentration of antibiotic on that discs. So we can compare that with the name. And you've recorded your results on this chart. We're going to compare your results with these three columns right here. Now on the top of the columns, it says R. R equals resistance. I equals intermediate, S stands for sensitive or susceptible. Now notice the numbers below. These are all in millimeters. That's why you had to record the diameter in millimeters. Notice that we have 12. That's the smallest number. Then the next is 13 through 17. And then the next is 18, the largest. We're going to compare our answers in this column with these three columns as mentioned. So let's look at the R. Do we have any of our results that are the same number or less? And we do. For instance, our zone of inhibition diameter for chloramphenicol was 6 millimeters. So notice that it says R equals millimeters or less. 6 is less than 12. So that means that chloramphenicol is a bad drug because the bacteria is resistant to that antibiotic. 24 is less than 28. 14 is less than 17. 10 is less than 12. So these four antibacterial reagents are not a good choice because the bacteria is resistant. So it has no effect on the growth and should not be used to treat the infection. Let's look for the intermediate zones. We have erythromycin. Erythromycin gave us a zone of inhibition of 18 millimeters. That falls in between 14 and 22. So erythromycin has a little effect on the bacterial growth, but not enough that it would be a good drug to treat the bacteria. So it's kind of a gray zone. The remaining are tetracycline, streptomycin, and kanamycin. These zones on our results are greater or equal or greater to the ones on this chart. So 30 is greater than 19, 21 versus 15, 31 versus 18, etc. So these three drugs, tetracycline, streptomycin, and kanamycin, have a good effect on the bacterial growth. Therefore, we can say that the bacteria is sensitive or susceptible to these three drugs. These three drugs can be used to treat the patient's infection. So let's summarize the test. The Kirby-Bauer test is used to determine if a particular bacterial isolate is sensitive to the drug. In this case, we found that the bacterial isolate that infected this patient was sensitive to tetracycline, streptomycin, and kanamycin. Now, one of these drugs can be used to treat the patient. Also, we can see if the isolate is resistant or intermediately resistant to these drugs, and these drugs would not be used to treat infection. So that concludes the video on the Kirby-Bauer test.